So this project started well over a year before we actually landed in Svalbard. I remember I was in Cape Town photographing some of the world's most hostile and dangerous gangs in Mitchell's plane, and thinking to myself, what would be next? What's the next project? And I was kind of found myself in the middle of nowhere, really, in terms of my thoughts. And so I naturally went to the opposite. I thought, well, what's opposite to here on the planet? And what would be opposite in terms of people and environment? So after my initial research into Svalbard, I discovered that people don't give birth there or even die there. I found out also that it is dark for several months of the year and then light for the other several months. There is virtually no vegetation that can grow on the island, and the last tree line is hundreds of miles away back in Norway. In fact, Svalbard it's a desert. So this naturally grabbed my attention with a few key questions. Who would choose to live there? And why? Travelling from London to 79 degrees north of the planet was long, and throughout the whole journey, I was thinking to myself, what started off as a thought a year before has got me this far. This project nearly didn't happen for so many reasons. Communication with the island was probably the hardest hurdle we had to cross, but Lynn, our producer, kept persisting, and finally we saw some light. Logistically, it was tough. For this reason, I thought this project would never happen. I guess this was another experience for me to learn patience and to let go of that controlling insecurity that I have, and maybe many artists have. And this alone was a question on my own identity, so even from this point I was learning. So finally we landed and it happened, it hit me. The environment, the fresh crisp air, the freezing temperature and everything else just instantly humbled me, and I just couldn't wait to get started. So later that day, we met with Vlad, our fixer, who's been living in Svalbard for 4 years, but originally from Moscow. One of my first observations of Vlad was his rifle, but once he briefed us on the dangers of polar bear attacks, I quickly understood why rifles must be worn outside of the settlement. Svalbard is so remote, things that we take for granted like phone signal and internet are a luxury to the people living there, so a lot of the communication and planning had to take place in this initial meeting. So after this, our feelings of anxiety were quickly swapped with excitement, and we just couldn't wait to get started. Barentsburg now. It's like minus 15, 7 a.m. Yeah, we're good to go. Just packing up the scooters. Vlad, our fixer, decided to tell us the dangers that we had ahead of us to do with the snow and avalanches, as well as probably one of the biggest dangers being polar bears and polar bear attacks, coupled with the fact that none of us had ever driven the snow scooters, kind of a little bit of fear in us. Yeah, when we're in the wilderness, we've got to get our priorities right. Frozen biscuit. We would stop and look around us in complete and utter silence, and just humbled by how powerful and how insignificant you are compared to nature. Nothing could have prepared us for what we were about to embark on with this trip from Longyearbyen to Barentsburg. The weather was so hostile, but so beautiful, and the weather up there in the Arctic can change very, very quickly. One minute it was clear and stunning and the colours were so vivid, and the next minute it was a complete whiteout. After several hours of ploughing through the snow, minus 30 conditions and ice cracking and tipping myself off my own scooter, we finally made it. And at that point I was just happy that we all made it there safely. Thank you.
whiteout was crazy. Yeah, it was a couple of times that, you know, the ice cracking as well. I'm glad we're here, and it's
what do you think it's going to be, you know?
Ex-communist. Baron. Barentsburg. It's kind of... It's barren. In more ways than one.
You don't know where to start. Yeah.
In all these houses,
right.
At most, they were like 1,500.
Right. So now all these apartments are empty? Yeah?
Yeah, some of them are empty.
There's 250 people here.
Huh?
There's 250 people here.
Yeah.
And you've got all of these blocks and apartments.
Yeah, but it will be some new time for Barentsburg, because it will turn into...
You think it'll populate again?
I think it will turn mostly into this tourism.
Tourism.
Yeah, into the tourism block. So then it will be...
Mountain here. The light is...
So Barentsburg and all of its complexities, you know, for me it was a case of, from the very beginning, this search, this curiosity, you know, what is it? How, what does it look like? And obviously we've arrived and we're getting this sense of dynamic and trying to find a pace, a rhythm. I think it's always best to never go in headstrong, but get to know people and get to introduce yourself to people and find what the energy is like there. But the biggest questions for me were, who is the man who chooses to live in a place like this? Who is the person behind it all? Who is that face that I'm looking for? For me, this is what I wanted to seek out, and this is what I wanted to document and to understand. We were introduced to Valerie via our fixer. Initially, my thoughts of Valerie were, here's this guy with this typical sort of Russian guy that's really tall and big built, lots of muscles, and he's going to be as hard as nails. But actually, it came to the reality that he's actually a really soft-natured guy, quite reserved and shy. So we initially just touched base and explained why we were there and let him understand the purpose of this. And I found that via talking to him and finding out that he's a musician by night and during the day he's a music teacher, that the community just instantly sort of expanded for me. After photographing Valerie, he invited us to listen to his band rehearsal. It was pleasantly strange being introduced to the other members of the band and listening to the band play their version of heavy metal Russian music. But it was the contrast between sitting down and eating crisps and Snickers bars whilst listening to this music in a Russian hotel in the Arctic that really sort of struck a chord with me. The members of the band were different, to say the least, and there was this quiet man in the corner playing his violin, and it was kind of strange that there was even a violinist in this metal kind of jazz fusion band, but he had this weird persona about him, and his name was Victor. For me, meeting Victor was one of the most moving experiences. I mean, initially, when we first met him, he was very hesitant to sort of even be introduced, but once we had dinner two or three times together and we sat down and I explained to him the purpose of me being there and what I'm seeking for, and he explained what he does. During the day he's a miner and by night he's a violinist, as well as being a husband and a father. This was moving, but I think the depth in Victor's story and in his outward appearance was the thing that captivated me. His eyes have got this sense of empathy almost, and he has this warmth to him that I just felt elevated towards. So later on that day, we were invited to go and visit the local community centre, which is also their gym and theatre and swimming pool. So we walked in and we were all taken back by how decrepit and beaten down this place looked, and in many ways it was dead. So we hung around for a few hours, and people from the community started to come in dribs and drabs, and after speaking to a few of the people that were there, we soon established that this place wasn't dead. In fact, it was the very life of Barentsburg. And this added a whole new dynamic. Is this gonna be the place that we're gonna meet the heart of the people? So it was a case of just sitting back and meeting people, really.
No, Barentsburg has been an amazing experience. You know, it's everything I thought it would be and more. I'm sort of really taken back by the sense of sort of community here. And it has to work that way because everyone has to get on. And I find it really interesting that people have, like during the day they're a coal miner, and in the afternoon they're a teacher, and then in the evening they're a chef or something. To be this far north in the world, in the Arctic, and have a community here, it's just random.
So, this is Barentsburg, a place of 250 people. The vast majority are miners who have left their families behind in other countries. But it seems that everybody there has a story. I mean, no one's born there, no one dies there, no one's from there. But people choose to stay there. Some for different reasons to others. Some it's for work, some it's maybe because they're escaping something. And for others, maybe it's just for the experience. So you wasn't born here, no?
No, nobody's. It's very. It used to be before, but I have stayed here for 18 years.
18 years you've been
yes.
here.
Mm-hmm.
And where did you come from originally?
I come from north of Norway, middle of Troms, near Senja. Nice island.
How do you find living in Svalbard?
You know, I came up because one friend of me started a study here, and she started call me and say, Marian, you have to come up here. It's so great. You will love it. And I said, no, I'm not go up to all the size because I used to live in Kenya before. And then after 1 year after, I was here. But you know, I wasn't supposed to stay here for 18 years. I was supposed to stay here for 2 years.
Yeah, yeah.
And then so a lot of things happened around me. So. I'm still here.
Mm.
You know, when you start with things.
How would you describe Svalbard?
Svalbard, wow, Svalbard is great, you know, and the nature is when you come out from Longyearbyen, it's amazing.
Actually, I came to Arctic to work a little bit, couple of months. But then I liked that. I decided why not to try to find a job here. So then I came to town and started to look for a job. Yeah.
And what was it like living here?
Life is strange. I think this is the most nice description. Life is really strange. We deal with weapons, with scooters, with dog sledging teams, and like in normal life, I don't think you will talk a lot about that. But here on Svalbard, yeah, we do.
My name's Jason Roberts. I moved to Svalbard through Norway because I'm originally from Australia. I had a couple of years in northern Norway in the Samish reindeer herding area before by chance I ended up on Svalbard. I feel that Svalbard is in the polar regions. It's quite a special region of the planet, and the way to describe it is it's probably one of the most alien environments for most people on the planet. Most people live in the temperate environments around the equator or semi-temperate, and the poles are like this alien environment, and very few people will actually ever visit the Antarctic or the Arctic.
Questions have been answered and some more questions have arisen. But I guess the key question was, does it change someone's identity? And coming to an extreme environment like Svalbard in general, and then migrating further to, in my opinion, more of an extreme environment like Barentsburg, and to live in those conditions. For me, meeting the people there with their love and their hospitality and their warmth in such a contrasted environment that's so cold and hard, for me showed me that the environment that we live in does dictate who we are to an extreme, but it doesn't necessarily form who we are.